the children's literature scholar as two-headed creature, Lofting and Damrosch. World versus global literature. Time has passed since having a PhD in children's literature was a joke in You've Got Mail. Children's literature research is now among the most dynamic fields of literary criticism and education, and has a bright future ahead of it, as children's writers and publishers invent more and more forms of young people's literature, and researchers find more and more sophisticated ways of exploring them. These words to announce the 2017 publication of a children's literature textbook in Edinburgh can undoubtedly just as well be applied to the state of children's literature study in Poland. The release date of the film mentioned, 1998, about the owner of a small bookstore threatened by a large franchise, is therefore significant. At this time, Poland was slowly seeing the end of its bad decade of the commercialization of children's books, and saw the first sign of a new epoch of beautiful books that continues to our day. In the early 21st century, Polish children's book scholars gave up their sense of inferiority to great literature scholars once and for all, just as the children's book was liberating itself from the Cinderella complex. The Lilliputian publishing houses began overtaking the larger ones. Contrary to all the market laws, and although it was not a victory in purely economic terms, it had significant repercussion in the culture. Specialists in field will muddy this lovely picture with their awareness of the present crisis of readership, the great dip in young readers. A devil's advocate might say that the relative upswing in children's book sales at the turn of the 20th and 21st centuries could be tied to the adult having previously abandoned the field in favor of more alluring fields of culture, and pop culture in particular. I have no intention of reiterating the ritual mourning over the crisis in the humanities. My task is far more humble. I would like to present the main contradictions at the heart of academic research into children's literature, especially those that are visible from a Polish perspective. These have been growing at present alongside the sharpening, though sometimes covert, conflict between the particular and local on the one hand, and the general and widespread on the other. To this we might add another phenomenon, the tension highlighted by literary scholars between world and global literature. This translated into an opposition between the scholar as an interpreter of single outstanding works and as an explorer hunting for new trends on the world literary market. The central thesis of my paper was inspired a definition by David Damrosch from the end of his What is World Literature, 2003, in a chapter titled World, Enough and Time. Let us take the time to recall and briefly comment of this key explanation. First, world literature is an elliptical refraction of national literatures. Second, world literature is writing that gains in translation. Third, world literature is not a set canon of texts, but a mode of reading, a form of detached engagement with words beyond our own place and time. This three-point definition, which holds true for all of world literature, is no less accurate when it's come to world children's literature. Works that have been circulating for 50, 100 or 150 years in translation, and even more importantly, among readers around the world. Works that have been the source of inspiration, paraphrase and allusion. Thus, we repeat, world children's literature gained through translation and its various refraction are found interesting and creative literary forms. This explains the key significance of translation study, which is developing brilliantly in children's literature and seems to have a bright future ahead of it. Commentators have called attention to the contrast between elite artistic world literature and the mass production of books on a global scale. Przemysław Czapliński note, quote, it is highly characteristic that the world literature scholars Damrosch, Moretti, Casanova, Thompson see globality as a domain of airports and train station bookstores. This was how scholars separated world literature from global literature. Available almost everywhere, affordable, written in a language almost everyone can understand, not bothering anyone's head with the problems of a local region, not even demanding that their titles or authors' names be remembered. The radical and therefore highly suspicious division between world and global literature has become a founding exclusion. After marking off these boundaries, scholars can explore the cultural geography of the Nobel Prize, but need not be bothered with the novels of Dan Brown or J.K. Rowling. End of quote. Scholars of children's literature can pass on Dan Brown, but not J.K. Rowling anymore. They know this famous book series is promoted on a global scale, but they do not question of Britishness of the Harry Potter books, interestingly reflected in a combination of fantasy and quasi-realism. As in Paul Azar's famous statement, England could be reconstructed entirely from its children's books, we could tell the tale of the history of British schooling from the novel's depictions of the four houses of Hogwarts, as well as all of England, Wales, Scotland and Ireland with their customs and sense of humor. And from the emotional atmosphere accompanying the Triwizard Tournament, we can even draw conclusions about why Brexit happened. Children's literature has less rigid division into high art and popular because the ties and affiliation with popular culture and before that with folk culture have been part of it ever since they were children, in the sense of offspring was used to mean people of a lower estate under the dominion of a lord, that is the paterfamilias. Can you go in two directions at once? The second inspiration for my paper was a metaphor used by David Damrosch, drawn directly for Hugh Lofting's famous series about Doctor Dolittle and his animals. Damrosch recalls a fantastical two-headed creature, push me, pull you, and an Egyptian sign depicting a two-headed animal. End quote. A multicultural animal related to the Abyssinian gazelle and the Asiatic chamois on my mother's side, as he tells the doctor, adding that my father's great-grandfather was the last of the unicorns, the story of Dr. Dolittle. He seems well suited for a multi-temporal comparatism as well, as he has two ancient precursors, Janos, the Roman guardian of portals, and also an older, more exact analog that Lofting probably did not know, the Egyptian hieroglyph, determinative for the verb kns, K-H-N-S, to go in two directions at once. End of quote. This fantastical creature, a combination of a gazelle and a unicorn, symbolize moving in two directions at once, and might also embody the children's literature scholar placed before contradictions and forced to do the impossible, to reconcile the micro and the macro, to classify hundreds of books and evaluate individual titles. We should recall that metaphors have their own logic. If common sense say that you cannot go in two directions at once, one must stop and observe things carefully, ourselves and others. The utopia of Republic of Children. Children's literature was recognized as world literature at the 1930s. The République universelle des enfants, the World Republic of Childhood, posited by Paul Azard, was the first Republic of Children proclaimed before World War II. The ideal model of mutually advantageous book and idea exchange, suggested by Azard, was, however, more of a premise than a reality. As he phrased it, quote, every country gives and every country receives. Innumerable are this exchange. And so it comes about that in our first impressionable years, the Universal Republic of Childhood is born. This République Universelle des Enfants. The correspondence between Azard's project and a later concept by the recently deceased French scholar Pascal Casanova, her word Republic of Letters, La République Mondiale des Lettres, 1999, would not seem an accident. This compels to isolate the prime meridian of literature. For children's books, the widely acknowledged center from which the distance to the periphery and semi-peripheries is marked is in the English-speaking countries, somewhere between London and New York. On a macro scale, political and economic factors have been dominant forces in what is purely literary. The canon, or the list of most popular books. From the point of view of the center, the issue of local canons seems rather irrelevant, though sometimes their comparison allows us to grasp multicultural differences. Among the top 100 titles found in library catalogs around the world, books for children and young people are generously represented for understandable reasons. The list has been created using WordCat, the world's largest database of library materials. Although we would do well to analyze all the cases, I will focus only on books for children and younger teenagers. In second place, after the adult Don Quixote, which has also been published in abridged adaptation for younger readers, we find a book without which we cannot understand contemporary culture, Alice's Adventures in Wonderland. Coming in third, the highly American Disadventures of Huckleberry Finn, and number four, Tom Sawyer, by the same author, Mark Twain, which also enjoys a fine reputation in Poland. the prince and the pauper is a number 63, we realize the scale of publication of Twain books when we add that Connecticut Yankees are in King Arthur's court is a number 81, 81st. At 13 is A Christmas Carol by Dickens. More of his books are found in the top 100. And on 15, Little Women, 1868 by Louise May Alcott, which has been adapted for screen on four occasions. At number 18 is The Hobbit by Tolkien. Two volumes of his Lord of the Ring come later. At 30 is The Wizard of Oz. At 33, The Secret Garden. And at 35, The Little Prince from a country which, as we know from Azar, has made only a minor contribution to children's literature. At 39, we have Great Britain again, The Wind in the Willow. And 40, Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, while another volume in the series, Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets, is at 66. At number 46, we have Heidi, representing the German language countries, Switzerland especially. Number 51 is The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, the first volume of Lewis's Septology. At 52 is The Italian Pinocchio. At 57, The Canadian Anne of Green Gable, which has been very important in Poland. And at 58, we have The Black Beauty by Anne Seville, written in 1877, a book that became known much later in Poland through a film adaptation. At 59 is the famous Peter Pan. Place number 92 goes to Charlotte's Web by Evelyn Brooks White, first published in 1952. This date unequivocally shows that the book had no chance to become known in the Eastern Bloc countries. In Poland, it was first translated in 1998. But now it's only gained popularity through the film adaptation. Most surprising of all is number 98, The Swiss Family Robinson. This is the English translation of an adaptation of Robinson Crusoe by Wyss, Johann Wyss from Switzerland, 1811. Known in Poland in the 19th century as Robinson Schweizarski, but at present all but forgotten, even in German-speaking countries. From this quantitative overview, we can make out many rules. The global perspective rules out the presence of the book by Astrid Lindgren or any other Swedish author in the top 100. Representing a minor literature of a minor European language, however major in maybe as children's literature. This somewhat eases the pain we feel of finding that the top 100 feature not a single book written in Polish for adults or children. Rounding out the top 500, we do find Quo Vadis. Let us recall that in 1912, Sienkiewicz wrote in Desert and Wilderness, well aware of the formula for a bestseller in Anglo-American world. This list goes to show that network of libraries always show a prevalence of works translated into English, but also of the American 20th century canon over the British one from the 19th century. And thus, we ought to understand the contemporary worldwide popularity of those British works, which have been well known and appreciated in the US from some time. From a European and non-English speaking perspective, this list is instructive, but it cannot be our sole source of the local canon. Globalization and localization. At present, locality and globality are not a simple cultural opposition. They interweave one an economic and social level, and in terms of literature as well. This weave has led sociologists to coin the phrase glocalization to describe a more complex phenomenon of providing specially adapted offers for local markets. Locality and globality are not an unequivocal opposition for children's literature scholars either. Juan Gutierrez has described the dialectic of the local and the global dimensions in children's literature. Quote, globalization is historically a multidimensional and polycentric process that comprises multiple intentionality and crisscrossing projects on the part of many agents. Literature is significant space from which to assess cultural shifts caused by socioeconomic and political processes related to globalization, and it serves as a place wherein the network society can unfold and be represented as a local imagined community. The global-local dialectic also impacts upon the development of subjectivity, such that identity and the self take on global, local, and glocal dimensions. End of quote. The significance of this research is also underlined by Emer O'Sullivan, who presently is shifting the focus from the globalization and commercialization of children's literature in the glocalization. A challenge for comparative children's literature is therefore addressing and analyzing the globalization of children's literature as the concomitant glocalization, which exists in the dialectic between global phenomenon and uniformity on the one hand, and the resurgence of the local on the other. Glocalization has various incarnations. However, from a mechanistic adaptation of models and formats for local use to the creation of new equivalents of those models, or for original local works that address more than just the local expectation. I'm not sure if the signals of growing interest in Slavic motifs should comfort or worry us in this regard. We should note that Polish children's literature has been given an opportunity. Its recent accomplishment pointing the way. A Polish Nobel Prize winner, a certain fantasy novel series and Polish computer games, and finally to approach the topic at hand, International Hours for Polish Artist Picture Books for Children. There is no recipe for world success, but it probably cannot be a calculated endeavor. It must be a work that emerged from an authentic passion for a local history of universal significance. It should be thought through entirely. It should borrow from the best past models. It should not be strictly a topical book, even if the theme is highly necessary and desired. A good children's book ought not to be reminiscent of popular series, which we called upon produce episode or on rare disease or crimes against the elderly for social campaigns. Many difficult contemporary issues are echoes of such morally just campaign. To remain true to itself, children's literature should be interested and powered by the imagination, the head of our titular unicorn-like creature remind us of just this fact. Looking both ways, Let us return to a classic children's book first published exactly 100 years ago in order to ask what it says about us and our children's literature. More than other authors of his day, Lofting was open to the world of animals. And as a man of his time, he depicted the other dark-skinned people in a paternalistic way we presently find hard to accept. Take whatever children's books you please, and you call can call out the whole world that produced it. There are works whose potential has not been fully exploited despite all their research, such as Alice in Wonderland. As I write this, I do not have in mind the whole library of existing interpretation, but the fact that every sentence of the book is loaded with multidimensional references to British culture. The worst thing that a scholar of children's literature can do is ignore its complex cultural codes. Neglecting the subject of study is a cardinal sign in various disciplines, but it can be especially dangerous here because of the apparent simplicity of topics for children. Meanwhile, what we find in the course of an intercultural reading has a real application to important sociological diagnoses. An excellent example is the Bullerby syndrome described in 2017, exploring the mechanism of causes of the emergence of an idealized image of Sweden in contemporary German culture. A first study of the reception of Astrid Lindgren's most popular novel in Poland tells us something crucial about the situation in Poland after 1957, when the government began permitting translation from Western languages and the transmission of news from countries beyond of the Iron Curtain. This coincided with changes in translation strategies of children's books, which meant signals of Swedishness, described by Hanna Dymel-Czebiatowska, were partly salvaged in the translation, making Lindgren's book compulsory reading for many generations of Polish children, promoted the Swedish ideal in the way that cannot be compared with the advertising campaign of any other part of the world. Alongside this adventure book of Soviet pioneers, schools in communist Poland suddenly had a book that allowed children to imagine a peaceful, democratic country, which was different from Poland, but in a deeper sense, from its tie to agrarian culture, quite similar. It was six Bullerby children and not the domestic children of Leszczynowa Górka, Hazelwood Mountain, that taught acceptance of the rural cultural heritage in Polish literature for adults, for this took a much longer time coming. The potential of many books entirely defined by their times has been exhausted by their reception, which does not mean scholarship will not return to term as statesmen symptomatic of their epoch. One paradox of children's books is the contrast between their necessary simplicity and the meanings that conceal, including veiled references to the reality beyond the literature. The ability to plug this out of children's literature is closely tied to intercultural reading, while it's hardest to gain a picture of the world surrounding us in contemporary books from our own cultural sphere. As such, there is no universal list on controversial topics. Those which are presented as such are seldom really taboo subject in a culture prepared and consciously presented to readers and difficult subjects. The contrast between what is visible and what is implied in the text would be worth investigating. We need only to remain wary of what the institution tells us, the schools, popular psychology, and education theory. Education history is an interesting contrast between an overt moral and the real message of a book. A clear example would be books from the turn of the 19th and 20th centuries about well-behaved children that win adults' hearts. They proclaim the ideal of the good child, while showing how unpredictable and irresponsible adults can be. What the authors were consciously trying to get across to children and what is written in the plot could be called the tip of the iceberg. Only a small part of it is visible above the ocean surface. Yet in our day, when icebergs are melting, we need to take a good look in those parts of children's work that have long gone unseen. Local offerings are far better than global and standardized products. Yet, even the latter ought to be researched from a cultural perspective, with a touch of suspicion and wary trust. Conscious of their work, scholars do not really run the risk on impetuously pursuing one term after another in the humanities, especially given that many of these, such as geopoetics or ecocriticism and the animal term, and post-dependency studies in our part of the world are tailor-made for studying children's books, both recent and of times past. Let us return once more to Lofting's book, which, thanks to the recent film adaptation, is undergoing a resurgence in popularity, to quote a fragment that is key to our paper. "I notice," said the duck, "that you only talk with one of your mouths. Can't the other head talk as well?" "Oh yes," said the push-me-pull-you, "but I keep the other mouth for eating mostly. In that way, I can talk while I'm eating without being rude. Our people have always been very polite. Two heads allow us to adopt two perspectives at once. One is from a fairy tale, a unicorn head for inventing stories, and the other is an ordinary head that is busy eating, which for the purpose of this, perhaps overwrought metaphor, I see as the consumption of useful and nurturing content. The unicorn head is turned towards legend, fantasy, and the oldest stories that we devour and which we still feed to our children. The other, resembling an antelope, has much in common with gaining experience and with physicality, materiality, and the prosaic side of existence. It is responsible for eating and sustaining the creature existence. Conclusions. I would like to conclude by positing deeper interpretation based on multicultural perspectives. The choice of this animal, the hybrid two-headed creature, also points to the suggestion that we develop as much scholarly self-consciousness as we can. This too is a hybrid consciousness that acknowledges the contradiction of children's literature, a field of blurred boundaries, changing social and cultural condition under examined history and under the undeterminable future. I feel inclined to make a self-effacing meta comment on my own position toward a research subject that cannot entirely be pinned down. The interpreter of children's literature needs as much distance from herself as possible. The cautious and retiring protagonist of Lofting's novel, aware of its exceptional and fantastical genealogy, which condemns it to be a hybrid creature, did not agree to be shown in a circus. And if I ultimately adapted this fate, it was only for higher aims. The two-headed creature is such a vivid symbol of looking two ways at once that it could well resolve the present complexity of our situation if researching children's literature. Thank you.
Thank you very much for such an insightful look at our job, right, and the condition of children's literature right now and in the past as well, and also a kind of sweeping view at Polish and international literature. Thank you very much, Anna.